Sweetheart, the more... Okay, here we all are living in the world, right? With lots of people, friends, enemies, strangers, dramas, war zones, this and that, yeah? That's the world, right? You agree? So what we're discussing here is each of one of us changing our minds in relation to all that. So all you're doing is improving yourself, becoming more stable, more wise, less attached, less neurotic, less buying into rubbish, less angry, less jealous, less depressed, more wise, more skillful, more compassionate, more equanimity, more love, more ability to benefit others. You just keep getting better and better. So what's the question?
The other people around you, though, maybe...
They're just going to be the same as they are, normally. That's how they are. So then what? Then so what's the question?
If they're as they are, and say somebody's vengeful or jealous...
What?
If somebody's around you...
But that's what discussing other people, discussing ourselves.
No, their response to that.
What's the point? What's the question, Teresa? Practical question. If you get better and better and nice and nicer and wiser and wiser and more loving and more loving, then obviously your presence in everybody's life will be slightly improved, and they're going to love you more and like you more and be responding to you more and enjoying you more, and you'll be less neurotic and less... What's the question? It's sort of obvious.
No.
Well, what is the question, Teresa? Specific question. Not what way, Teresa?
If they are not as advanced.
That's naturally going to be that way. The Dalai Lama is surrounded by a load of rubbish like us. So what's the question? What's the question, Teresa?
Okay, there are people who want to kill the Dalai Lama.
So let them kill him. So then what's the question?
Well, that's the example.
What's the question, Teresa?
The question was, if you change like this, and there are people that, you're around with who have these heavy karma.
I understand that. So what's the question? None of that's relevant to this. It's just confusing me, that question. I don't know what you mean, darling. I don't know what it means. Although I'm so sorry, I can't help you.
I know.
All right. Thank you, Teresa. I can't help. Yes.
So when you said before...
Huh?
When you were saying before that everyone in this room has been my mother at one time, think on that, generate compassion.
Well, no, think they've all been your mother, therefore think of how they've been kind, how mother's kind, and therefore the deduction is they've all been kind to me, therefore the conclusion is next step, I must repay their kindness. That's the logical steps. Then? That's it.
Very good.
Is that what you meant? Yeah, this is the progression of the steps. First is equanimity. You realize they all want to be happy. Then you think all beings have been my mother. Then you think mother's been kind. Then you think must pay their kindness. It's four steps. You get to that point, then you keep moving, moving, moving. Each one leads to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next conclusion sort of thing. Then you have this enormous energy to want to repay their kindness, which causes you to practice for their sake. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Can we talk about these being sequential and building upon each other?
That's right.
We don't have to perfect.
No, you couldn't
first.
Do that. You couldn't. No, you couldn't. You wouldn't just keep practicing one piece in grade one till you perfected it. You only perfect it when you got to grade 20,
okay.
If you think about it.
Right.
You perfect it to some degree, which enables you to go to the next one, stretch yourself. But whenever you go back to the grade one piece, the person who creates grade one the best is the person who's Mozart.
Okay.
Do you see? You've got to practice. And the thing is, this is where we have a linear practice. We have a structure, very nice. But we can see in one day. You do a whole pile. One day you say a mantra. That's tantra. That's postgraduate. Then you do, then you say practice one day watching your karma. That's junior school. Then another time you watch your mind. That's high school. Then another time you practice forgiving somebody. That's university. We know all of them. But the point is you can't perfect grade six until you've got grade five down. And that's logical. So in other words, you can't possibly have valid compassion until you've got valid renunciation. So you practice them. To get one, you've got to have it after you've got this one.
So it's okay if we're sampling a buffet.
What have I said from this?
Yes, you said that.
That's
okay,
right.
Thank you.
Yeah. You must do that.
Yeah.
It's the whole deal, you know. But if some things you can't do, like Tong Len, is kind of intense. And if you're a complete victim who's overwhelmed by suffering at the moment because you've just begun your practice and you're victimised in some bullying relationship and you're too scared to change, you can't sit there and exchange self for others.
Mm-hmm.
You can't sit there and see that person as your friend. You've got to have enough courage to leave them. Mm-hmm. So we've got to know where we're at, what we can take on.
Okay.
Do you see?
Mm-hmm.
We've got to know our mind, what our progress is. Someone else? Nothing? Something? No? Nothing? Nothing? Everything's clear? All right.
I have a question.
Yes, sweetheart. Yes.
You said earlier, ultimate Buddha nature is the emptiness of our mind.
Yeah.
And so, those are words, and I'm not sure how that relates to.
You mean the experiential implication?
Right. You said even enlightenment is not
inherent.
Right.
Sure.
So how does Buddha nature fit into that?
It's just a way they talk. It's how they structure in these series of practices, how they talk about things. So what the implication of the main Buddha nature being the emptiness of your mind is the fact that your mind isn't stuck in stone, isn't permanent, isn't unchangeable, isn't inherent, which means it is empty, is why it can change. So all it means is your mind being empty is the main reason you can become a Buddha, because it's not stuck in stone. But it's just the way they talk. Do you understand? Yep. Yep. Yeah.
Might not be relevant, I'm not really sure how to say, but if you have limited understanding but you continue to practice and maybe you have mistakes, is there any way that that's garnered bad merit?
What do you mean by mistakes? What would be a mistake?
I thought I was having glimpses of emptiness and that was helping me, but I can see where my mistake is that I only an idea of it that's helped me.
What's wrong with that? So what's wrong with it? Why is that a mistake?
If I jump ahead, I feel like I'm losing something, like I'm losing benefit or something.
Uh-huh. That's true.
Like
so
I'm
then.
Trying to jump ahead and
right. So then, conclusion. Good. So conclusion. If you were practicing, have you got a skill? Have you got a skill?
Yes.
What is it?
I do body work.
Okay. So that body work, you initially learned it from somebody, didn't you?
Yes.
You had a teacher, right? They had a system and you followed.
Yes.
So your question is, if I do it wrongly, could I hurt somebody? The answer is probably yes. So what would be the caution you'd get from that? What would be the learning from that? What would you do from that?
Study.
Pardon?
Study.
Be more careful what your teacher says and do what they say. Well, same here. Same here, baby. Eventually, when you've got the skill down, you know that once you get better and better and better at it, you can start improvising, can't you? Because you've got the basic skills. And then you can start to trust your own inner massage therapist and get better and better at it. Would you agree? But if you leap ahead too quickly, you might make mistakes, wouldn't you? And you'd hurt people. Well, there's the same answer here. So take your teachings, take the course, be cautious to see what if you are following the system called Buddhism, you've got to see what the teachers say, what the instructions say, just like being a massage therapist. Same thing. Same, darling. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, I've run out of words. I think we've talked about, we've looked at the whole path to enlightenment, actually. We snuck it in, I always seem to, yeah, anyway, whatever. So, nature of mind, we're trying to look at the nature of mind. We're trying to see how our mind can change. We're trying to see Buddha's view that the mind naturally has the potential to change moment by moment and then ultimately to become an enlightened being. And we looked at the different steps in that, not necessarily all in order. We've been touching all the essential points. Emptiness, clarity of mind, beginningless mind, impermanence, karma, delusions, bodhicitta. We've really looked at all the components, haven't we? So our job is, I've been a bit sort of ad hoc about it all, but our job is if we're going to practice this path, if we decide to practice path, we don't have to, but if we do decide, then obviously like I'm saying here, you just take the instructions as well as you can, even though we might find some a bit confusing, mightn't do it exactly the same, but we try to get a sense of the structure of the path, try to get an overview of the path, and then try to develop some kind of practice, and then just keep moving. Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, the basic components of a daily practice, which can calm our minds down, because there is so much information here, it is a vast system, it's really outrageous. We think, my God, where can I begin? What do I do with all this information, you know? Of course we can think this. But we just be humble. We start with something small. So the ideal scenario for a day is to have something in the morning and something at night. You have these little two bookends that prop up your day, you know? So the main components of a decent practice in this tradition would be some components of concentration, some components of using the Buddha, that is to say visualizing, imagining the Buddha, including mantra, let's say, some component of analysis, and then some component of purification. If you've got those, you've got a perfect infrastructure for a perfect practice. So in the morning, it would mean your first thing. Ideal scenario would be to do something first thing in the morning. I mean, why? Because we know we're totally lazy. We'll put it off and we'll do it later, we say, which of course means we won't do it because we can't be bothered. So the key thing is to have a discipline. It's helpful to have a discipline. But to have a flexible mind that if you can't do it, you've got a good reason not to do it. And the key thing here is not to believe our own propaganda. We are our own worst enemy when it comes to all the stuff in our head. We lie to ourselves brutally every day. We're constantly trying to find rational, logical reasons why we shouldn't do this and can't do that. It's not fair and I can't do this, blah, blah. We've got to be very rational and clear. So the ideal scenario is you get up in the morning. And first of all, the very first thing would be to have a thought. Oh my God, I'm still awake. I can't believe it. I'm still alive. Notice that you're still alive. Notice that you didn't die yet. And that's so profound because one of the delusions here that we're attacking is this assumption of permanence. There's an assumption that I'm going to live forever, even though I know it's a joke. Of course we don't think we're going to live forever, but it's as if we do. The fact is, Buddha says, you know, in this little structure that our teacher has in his lamb room, the first meditation he gets us to do is to think about the impermanence, in particular, of one's own death and one's own life, and one is going to drop dead any minute, you know? Well, we know that. Yeah, all right, it's kind of boring, but it's very profound for our mind. The first step is to think that death is definite, but the second one is kind of intense. It's to think that time of death could be at any time. Logically, this is true. If you don't know now, if you can't answer the question, when will you die? And I mean put a time and a date on it. Now, unless, of course, you plan to suicide yourself at that time, you have to say you're not certain. Is this not true? Yeah. It's logically true, but look how we feel. We can't even hear those words. If it's true that you will die at some point and you don't know when it is, well, it's logical to say I could die today. Isn't that logical? Look how we feel when we say that. We don't believe a single word of it. What does that prove? That I believe mostly that I'm permanent. So ingrained in our minds, it's hilarious. It should scare the life out of us. It should give us the most massive wake-up call we've ever had. Because if we were to die at 6 p.m. today, or even midnight, just try and imagine. If we were told we're going to be killed at midnight, I think we'd galvanise ourselves into action. We'd cut out all the rubbish. We'd forgive every single person we ever hated. We would not bother going home and having lunch. We'd sit down, read Dharma books and try to do our best to calm our minds down and realise I better sow a few seeds in my mind before I drop dead. Would we not?
Yes.
But we won't, will we? Why? Because we don't believe we're going to die today. I mean, it's hilarious. So Lama Zobi says, best to think I'll die today. And my feeling is for no other good reason than the fact is, guess what? What's the name of the day you're going to die?
Today.
So you might as well get used to it. That's my feeling. Do you understand? It's sort of hilarious, isn't it? You don't die tomorrow. That's ridiculous. You die today. Just that we don't expect it. Oops-a-daisy. You know. So it's really very helpful to think like this. The moment you think you could die today, the moment you think you're impermanent, the practical application of that thought isn't fear, like we think. It is, oh my God, I better start doing something about it. So then you straight away adjust your mind. You straight away try to have virtuous thoughts. You straight away try to forgive all the ridiculous rubbish and let go of all the nonsense because you could die at any minute. It's an extremely powerful practice. The very first one in junior school, incredible. Amazing. So to wake up in the morning and remind yourself, because we don't remind ourselves, because we assume, well, of course I'm awake, I'm me. Because we grasp at self-existent me. So we don't notice the truth. So the first thing when you wake up in the morning, even before you open your eyes, notice, state consciously, my God, I'm still alive. This is amazing. My petrol tank hasn't run out yet. I'm serious. Use whatever words you'd like. Well, then I better make the most of today. Then you hop out of bed. If you've got to practice, you go pee, you do whatever you do. Wash yourself, but go do your altar. My way of thinking is this, like this. If the Dalai Lama knock on your door and you open the door, this is the Dalai Lama. Let's say. My feeling is you would offer him a cup of tea at least, wouldn't you? Do you not? Mm-hmm. You wouldn't sit him down in the lounge and then go back and do your breakfast and say, oh, I'll meditate. I'll offer him a cup of tea later. Then he's waiting there 3 weeks later for you to make your offerings on your water bowl offerings on your altar. I don't think so. I think you'd offer him a cup of tea. Well, imagine he's knocking on the door and he comes in, so you've got to rush to your altar and do your water bowls, if you know how to do water bowls. If you don't, then ask somebody. If you don't, then don't want to, then don't matter. But that's your first practice. If you did nothing else, you'd be brilliant, you know. But right there, you can then just making offerings. This is purification and merit because you're relating to the Buddhas. It's very powerful practice, all that I'm going to say. Then you can sit down and do something. You have a cup of tea, have your breakfast if you want, but dangerous. Do your practice first, even if you do 5 minutes. I really, really mean it. Even if you do 5 minutes. You sit down, you take refuge, you do the seven limbs, you do a few little meritorious prayers and practices, and then you maybe visualize the Buddha, say a mantra, do anything. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, watch your breath for a few minutes, do whatever, and then dedicate. That's a perfect little practice, assuming, of course, you haven't got, you know, practical commitments. Then you watch your mind throughout the day. You'd be nice, try not to shoot off your mouth to too many people, try not to harm too many people. Watch your mind, adjust yourself as you're going along, and then at the end of the day, you do the four opponent powers. Practice, purification, which I think we've sent a PDF to somebody, so ask who has got that PDF, Megan. And
yeah, then people up on the Facebook page,
okay.
And we can send it out to you.
There's two documents. There's also the Heart Sutra Notes, which is about emptiness. For those of you who weren't there, you can have that or download onto your computer.
That's also up on the Facebook page.
And anybody else wants any other type of notes about things, you can just email me if you'd like. There's a Facebook page apparently there, you can email there.
Okay.
I'm happy to help. So that's a daily practice, people. Then you can just, you go one step at a time, like anything. Take some teachings, come to a course, and you keep building on that infrastructure, building your awareness, and you use throughout the day the teachings of the Buddha, impermanence, karma, compassion, emptiness, to apply to your daily life. You just don't live a samsaric life and then come and do a holy Buddhist practice. It's sort of like practicing tennis for 1 hour and then not think about it again. It's plain foolish. The Buddhism is Buddha's views about the world, and we're trying to use those views to interpret our life, which means you need to hear them and think about them, and then you attempt to apply them in your daily life. That's then full daily practice. And you do this one day at a time, and then you drop dead. But then you've got all these nice seeds in your mind. You can die with a happy mind. Bop along to the next life and keep on moving. It's not complicated. We just make it complicated. So there you go. Done. So I think we just finish. We think, do we have any prayers to do, Megan? Or normal prayers to do, sweetheart? I've got an advertisement first, sorry. I'll just do an advertisement. It says, there's a person called Robina Corton leading a pilgrimage to Burma in September. There's some postcards out there. It's to raise money for different projects, you know. And so I'll be leading a pilgrimage to Burma. Come with me, please. You're very welcome. There's postcards here and out the back if you'd like to email, check up what's going on, what it costs and all the rest. It's on there. There you go. That's my advertisement. I haven't been there before. It's going to be very exciting. Yeah? So let's do a little prayer. What, darling? Yeah, I think let's have a look, yeah, see what's going on. Just do a couple of little prayers.
So we hand out the prayer books.
Good darling.
Prayer of complete teachings you hear in the
shape. Okay, fine. Sure. Bring, dedication. And done. Sure. I'll find it.
Like one
more
prayer.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, okay. On page.
34,
okay. 34. So these words and these prayers, make them your thoughts, okay? They're very powerful. And remember, every thought is an intention which sows a seed in your mind similar to that thought, which will ripen in the future similar to that. So how marvelous to have thoughts about compassion, isn't it? Just to have those thoughts is blissful. So may the supreme jewel, bodhicitta, that has arisen, not arisen, which means in minds of people, arise and grow. And may that which has arisen not diminish, but increase more and more in the hearts of sentient beings, you know. And then we think of His Holiness, and we think of any of the holy beings. So they live long, 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 long lives because we need them badly. In the land encircled by snow mountains, you are the source of all happiness and good, all-powerful Chen, raising Tenzingyat. So please remain until samsara ends. Savior of the snowland teachings and transmigrating beings, who makes extremely clear the path that is the unification of emptiness and compassion, to the lotus holder Tenzingyat, so I beseech, may all your holy wishes be spontaneously fulfilled. May the glorious Guru's life be long and stable. May all beings equaling the extent of space have happiness. May I and others without exception accumulate merit and purify negativities, and may we be blessed to quickly attain Buddhahood. And then that will do. That will do.